Welcome, LA Progressive friends and family. Dick and I are delighted once again to be joined by Bill Blum, who is a former judge and death penalty defense attorney. He's the author of several legal thrillers published by Penguin Putnam, and he is a contributing writer to Truth Dig and LA Progressive. We're so happy to say. Welcome, Bill.
Thank you. Always great to be with you.
So, hi, Bill. So, most recently, you submitted an article called Trump and the Election Subversion Plot of 1787. So, here we are, 5 days from the election, and we're on pins and needles because it's not clear who's going to win. But then you point out that if we get past November 5th, then we have to face the fact that the MAGA world is prepared to do nasty things with the Electoral College. Can you tell us what's going on there?
Sure. So we are the only country that is, a putative democracy, supposed to be a democracy, which elects their chief executive, our president, not by popular vote, but by this Rube Goldberg kind of arrangement known as the Electoral College. And the Electoral College was established by the original Constitution, by the founding fathers, the 55 white men of property, as I call them, who met in Philadelphia in May of 1787 to initially revise the Articles of Confederation, but they wound up drafting a new constitution. And in order to do that, they had to make certain compromises because you had 13 colonies, now 13 sovereign states, who, if they were to come together and form a new country, they would have to compromise on certain issues. And the Electoral College was one of those big issues. And that was also bound up with another compromise called the Three-Fifths Clause, which, for purposes of apportioning representation in the House, allotted slave-owning states to count their slaves on the basis of three-fifths per each slave in the population that would determine the number of representatives in the House. And the number of representatives in the House, plus the two members of the Senate that each state would get, would determine each state's share of the Electoral College. So we don't elect by virtue of popular vote. We elect by virtue of this Electoral College. Now, today, each state, with some minor exceptions for Maine and Nebraska, which have two congressional districts which are separately counted, determine their Electoral College votes based on the popular vote cast within each state. But the Electoral College remains, and each state gets a certain number of electors, and those electors meet and they cast their votes. They cast their votes individually, but then they're all counted. And then when you come to the time for the votes to be counted in Congress, last time, January 6th of 2021, then it's whoever gets a majority of the Electoral College becomes president. Now that creates opportunities for mischief in various ways, which we saw in 2020. One would be to have competing state slates of electors from different states. Another, which in addition to that, but could operate independently, is if a sufficient number of senators and representatives object to the certifications that are submitted to Congress. Then, upon that number being certified in writing, it used to just be one from each. Now it's 20% of each chamber. The joint session of Congress is postponed, and each house adjourns and separately considers those objections. Another thing that the Electoral College does, setting aside this objection procedure, is that if nobody gets a majority of the Electoral College, the whole election is thrown to the House in what's called a contingent election. This is under the original Constitution and the 12th Amendment. And in that election, each House delegation gets one vote, not each representative. So if the Republicans, by virtue of gerrymandering, have more delegations than the Democrats, even though their overall vote total may be very much smaller, then those Republican delegations can carry the day in the contingent election and win the presidency. So all of these ramifications and wrinkles were taken into account by people like John Eastman and Kenneth Chesebrough to create this multifaceted and kind of complex election subversion scheme, which the Trump campaign put into motion and attempted to carry out on January 6th. And Congress tried to correct that by amending what was called the Electoral Count Act of 1887, and that governed how the election, how the electoral votes were going to be counted. Now we have a new act called the Electoral Count Reform Act of 2022. And without getting too much in the weeds, the new act is better, but it's not by any means a foolproof measure to safeguard against further subversion. So the Republicans are now fast at work, just as they were in 2020, to overturn the will of the majority if Kamala Harris gets a majority. And it appears that she might win the Electoral College. There are many avenues and methods for them to try to overturn that. So let me give you one example. Let's say that on January 6th, Kamala has 270 electoral votes. Trump has 268. And among those 270 is Pennsylvania. But Pennsylvania is very close. And we already know that Trump is claiming that there's fraud going on in Pennsylvania. So 20% of the Republicans in the House, 20% of the senators, and this is the new Congress, not the old one, would have to lodge written objections. When those objections are filed, the joint session is suspended and each chamber adjourns to consider the objections to Pennsylvania. Now, that's going to be a tough vote because if 50%, and this is a majority vote, if 50% of the House members and 50% of the senators, 50%, 51%, vote to sustain the objection. And it's not hard to imagine how they could do that. If the Republicans have a majority in the House and a majority in the Senate, they look like they're going to get a majority in the Senate and the new Senate. If they sustain the objection, then Pennsylvania's Electoral College votes are thrown out. And then the total is no longer 538, the denominator in that equation. It's 538 minus 19, and then whoever gets a majority of that. So if Pennsylvania's thrown out, assuming that it's Harris, then Trump would win. That's how it's going to go down. Now, Elie Mystal, who I like as an election and Supreme Court commentator, had an article in The Nation just the other day, which pretty much tracked with mine for Truthdig. And so this is what we owe to the founding fathers. This was a compromise they made. It was very elitist. They didn't want to have direct democracy determine the presidency, and so they made this compromise. And this compromise has resulted in five presidents being elected, even though they got the minority share of the popular vote, Trump being the most egregious one in 2016, and he might just do it again.
So it almost seems to me like, I mean, I know that there are a lot of people who do not want us to maintain this Electoral College, but we just can't seem to get rid of it.
Well, you need a constitutional amendment to get rid of it.
Right, right. So it seems to me that we really need to have a constitutional crisis in order for us to get to a place where we are going to give this some serious consideration.
Well, that may be true. Technically, it's probably true, but so far, the impetus for a new constitutional convention has come from the right, not from the left. Although one of the people that I regard as maybe the best legal commentator in the country right now, Erwin Chemerinsky, in his new book, really does say that we might need a new constitutional convention. His book is called No Democracy Lasts Forever. And I cite that in the article for Truthdig. And that's what he argues. But the practical reality is that right now it's the right wing that has the impetus for this new constitutional convention. And you can imagine all of the insane provisions that they would want to include in a new constitution. Balanced budgets, no abortion, et cetera, and so forth. So you're right. It's really the only way to get rid of the Electoral College outside of what's known as the Interstate Compact, which is an agreement among states to vote for the presidential candidate who gets a majority of the total popular vote. But that doesn't have a majority of states agreeing to it. So right now, that's not going to happen. This is really a tough situation to be in.
And in the meantime, it's tearing up the country, and not just this year. I mean, it's particularly obvious this year that this problem is a serious problem, but it's been a problem for a very long time. You just mentioned it. There have been five presidential elections when the winner of the popular vote did not become president of the United States.
That's correct. And it goes back to the founding of the country, and the founding fathers did not trust the masses to determine the president. The president was to be selected by an informed, propertied, intellectual elite. And they thought that would be better for the country, provide better stability and better people to become president. And that compromise was what we call a Faustian bargain. It's a bargain you make with the devil that comes back to haunt you, and it's haunting us more than ever with Donald Trump in 2024. Now, we might not even have an electoral crisis. Trump, this time around, could actually win.
So if the MAGA world and Trump pulls these shenanigans, and they seem, if the opportunity is there, this crowd and Trump seems like they would take advantage of it and to hell with democracy. But there would be such an outpouring of outrage if it was, you know, yes, you as a lawyer can, and Sharon can understand the complexities about how this is set up by the founding fathers, but it would stink to high heaven. And you would think that the country would revolt, except recall the Bush-Gore outcome, which was a blatantly stolen election. The Republicans sent an army of lawyers to Florida and they interfered with the process, and they blatantly stole the election, and people were upset and they got over it. And we invaded Iraq and we invaded Afghanistan. It had a horrible outcome, and yet we sort of just went on with it. And I fear that something like this could happen. We would be outraged and we would just go on, and Trump would call the tune for another 4 years, and that would be a dreadful outcome.
Well, see, I think that Trump makes George W. Bush look like a progressive.
Yeah.
So I think
it's I agree. Yeah.
And you've got a Supreme Court now, which is more and more compliant with the needs of the MAGA movement. So I don't think we can count on them to be a backstop. And you would have a president who would mimic what Andrew Jackson supposedly said to John Marshall. John Marshall made his order. Now let's see if he can enforce it.
Yeah.
If the Supreme Court dared to defy him on this vital, vital question, whether you're president or not, he'd say, well, you know what? I'm president. What are you going to do? Now, you mentioned Bush v. Gore and the army of lawyers. And of course, John Roberts was one of the chief legal advisors for that army of lawyers, now the Chief Justice of the United States Supreme Court, who has abandoned his role as institutionalist and now is clearly a MAGA partisan.
Right. Now, besides this topic being very interesting to academics and for people who, you know, just have their noses deep in politics, besides that, in the final analysis, these kinds of decisions have a huge impact on the lives of every single American. Every American will be impacted, and some more than others. In what ways, Bill, do you see if this turns out as badly as it could, how do you see the average American being impacted?
Well, I think that Elon Musk finally admitted what's going to happen, that there's going to be, he calls it temporary economic pain. Other people like Steve Bannon said, we're going to have chaos for a while because we're going to tear everything down and rebuild it. The average American is going to be impacted by high unemployment, accompanied at least initially by high inflation and by chaos and crime in the streets and by these tariffs if he tries to impose them, and a lack of regulation. So you could see Social Security and Medicare crumbling. You could see states trying to scramble to fill the void as social service budgets are cut back and being unable to. And that's why even conservative publications like The Economist are saying vote for Kamala, because in their view, and I'll just reduce it to the bottom line, she's not crazy.
But even without this crisis, the Electoral College has a definitely a dampening effect on the elections. Here in California, we care passionately about this election, but really our votes aren't going to matter. We're so heavily Democratic, and there are states that are so heavily Republican that essentially you just watch other states, what they call the battleground states, fight it out, and that twists things, because things that are going on in Michigan or Pennsylvania, local issues, may not have the same weight here in California, and yet our view of the world doesn't get expressed in the presidential.
There are a couple things. You're right in the big picture sort of things, because seven states are getting the attention, but you got to remember that there are congressional races.
Yeah,
very important, and some of them in California are very competitive. So to get back to the objections that the Republicans are probably going to lodge in the Pennsylvania example, that vote is majority vote. So if California has an even more Democratic congressional delegation, that could tip the scales in that vote. That's not a vote by delegation. That's a vote by majority. Same thing in New York. There are certain swing districts that are up for grabs. So there is a reason. At least in the districts, if you live in one, there's some say in Orange County that are competitive, to really be engaged deeply in this election, because it will affect your life.
Right. David Menn is running to replace Katie Porter. David Menn is running as a Democrat in Orange County, California. LA Progressive has endorsed him. And I'm just slipping his name in there because that's the topic that we're talking about right now. In Orange County, we need to have Katie Porter replaced by David Men and not by it.
She thought she could be senator, but
that's a whole nother topic and certainly a topic that's worthy of conversation, but we're not going to be talking about that right now. But speaking of the seven battleground states, you know, they get the lion's share of the presidential advertising. And this week, you know, we had the World Series. And I had never, living in Los Angeles, I actually had not seen any Trump campaign television ads until I watched the World Series. Sadly, it didn't turn out the way it was supposed to. But, you know, I'm from the Bronx.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Although I do live in Los Angeles.
You blew it, that five-run inning.
Yeah. But did you see those commercials? Those Donald Trump? I mean...
They were repulsive.
Well, they're all over the NFL games on Sunday. They've been
I don't watch sports. That kind of ad?
Yeah. Same ad, except the one that he came out in favor of overtime workers, which is really, it made me laugh because the Republicans want to do away with the Fair Labor Standards Act and time and a half for overtime. And he's coming out in this ad, you know, dressed in his McDonald's apron, saying, "I support the overtime."
Oh, he loves overtime workers. He doesn't pay.
You don't get paid for it.
He doesn't pay them. He doesn't. He doesn't pay them not just for the overtime, but just for the straight time.
That's right.
Yeah.
It's appalling.
It is appalling.
And the billionaire class loves him by and large. You know, you see what they're doing now with not endorsing a candidate, Jeff Bezos, owner of the Washington Post.
Yes.
That gets us into a whole separate discussion of how countries become autocracies.
Yeah.
Slide into fascism. Though historians of that phenomenon call it the authoritarian bargain.
Yeah, it's pretty sad.
Right.
But this finagling of the Electoral College plays into that, because it allows a fewer part of the populace to decide how the election is going to turn out And so the billionaires can put their emphasis there. I see that the Washington Post lost 250,000 subscribers. So expect your Amazon Prime bill to go up.
Well, you know, I've always maintained that the so-called founding fathers never intended for us to have a democracy. And you may call it a Faustian bargain, you can call it what you want. They intended for the elite to rule. I think they wanted an oligarchy, which is what we have.
Oh, definitely. I agree with you.
Yeah.
Look, people, when I was teaching constitutional law at USC, I used to start the class on voting rights by asking how many people think that they could have voted in the first presidential election. And I look around the room and I maybe pick out two or three people that I thought would qualify. And of course, I wasn't included.
No, of course not. Dick would have been in there.
That's right, Dick. You could have voted.
Yeah. All right. Well, it's always a pleasure talking to you, Bill. Hopefully the next time we talk, maybe there'll be some good news. You know?
Yeah, maybe there'll be a President Harris, for one thing.
Let's pray.
And let's also pray that if there is a President Harris, that the vast majority of us will have learned that electing the president isn't the end all and be all of being engaged politically. There's so much more that we still need to do.
It's the start, you know. I mean, that's the real advantage of Kamala Harris and Tim Walz is
buys us time.
They can be they can be pushed in directions we'd like them to be pushed. We don't have the money to push Trump anyplace. Anyway, he's too damn big.
And for young people who might be watching this, they believe in climate change. The other side doesn't.
Mm. Right.
Yeah, well, we don't really believe we don't know what the other side believes, except they believe that they need to make more money.
Right. Well, thank you, Bill.
Sure.
Hope you feel well.
Thank you so much.
All right. So long.
Thank you for sticking around. If you like the LA Progressive content and the discussions we have here, please consider clicking the subscribe button below and also give us a thumbs up. That helps to grow our audience by feeding the algorithm, which helps to get this content in front of more eyes. Thanks for stopping by. We really appreciate your support.